Hare Krishna Govindpuru, welcome back to the Monks Podcast.
My
It's
pleasure to
wonderful
be.
to have you here once again. So Prabhu, today I thought we could discuss on the topic broadly of three parts, you know, about racism, because that is a burning issue in the West right now, racism and racist violence. And then there is a perception that the Vedic texts also are racist, at least some sections in them seem quite racist. And then we could talk broadly about how dharma and spirituality can offer some solutions to racism, the problem of racism. Is that okay?
Yes, yes.
Okay.
My pleasure to discuss.
Thank you. So I'll just read broadly from Wikipedia. I'll share the screen so that you can also see. What is the definition of racism? So it is a belief that groups of humans... So you can see what is it there, no?
Yes, yes.
It is believed that groups of humans, that possess different behavioral traits corresponding to physical appearances and can be divided based on the superiority of one race over another. So basically, some races are superior to others. It may also mean prejudice, discrimination, or antagonism directed against other people because they are of a different race or ethnicity. And there's much more, but we could come back to this later. So basically, racism, at least as it is understood in the common sense, is that the notion that some groups of people are superior to others, or we consider some groups of people to be inferior to others. So in Western history, we had the idea that there was the idea that the whites are superior to the blacks, and the blacks were enslaved, and often the very prosperity of the white nations and the white races was considered evidence of their superiority. And then Hitler took that further and said that the Germans, Nazis, are superior to everyone. And of course, the Jews he considered to be the cause of the downfall of humanity. And then he tried to annihilate the Jews. So from that time onward, the idea that there is racial superiority, that started being strongly condemned in the Western world. And then, of course, even before that, slavery was removed in America. And now there are strong riots because there is a perception that blacks are being discriminated against by the police. So basically, the idea that one race is superior to another or another race is inferior to another. So that idea is what is racism. So any thoughts on this?
Yeah, very interesting that, you know, I remember talking to one scholar. He says that the human weakness makes you feel that you are superior. And when that human weakness is concentrated, systematized, that human weakness becomes human brutality to the extent where it becomes demonic in nature, where a group of people are willing to undermine, systematically colonize or destroy the other race. Therefore, racism has to be dealt in two ways. When a person exhibits, he needs to be taught. When a group of people exhibits, it has to be fought against. No? So therefore, what I see, it will always remain amongst the human beings to feel proud of their birth.
Okay.
So they should be taught. I remember listening to one American comedian. He said, you know, how stupid it is to say that I'm a proud American. Just because you're biologically born, if you're becoming proud, that shows that you are so insignificant because you have nothing to contribute. So therefore, you are borrowing strength from your birth. He said the pride should come based upon your growth, your contribution. Even that is not good. But even if it has to come, let it be natural and real and mathematical. Mm. But this is so stupid, idiotic, and blind.
Okay. So this is quite a lot you said. So last point, if I take it. So what you're talking the nationalism and racism, the underlying mentality is the same, that we are
yes.
trying to borrow strength from some group identity. rather than being strong oneself through one's own character, one's own growth, one's own contribution, one tries to borrow strength from one's some group identity.
Yes.
That's why you started by saying that it begins with weakness. So I feel that I am weak and therefore I need to borrow strength from somewhere. Okay. That's quite a profound psychological insight. Now, there is also said to be one contemporary thinker, he has said that there's a difference between, say, patriotism and fascism. So patriotism is the idea that my country is special, but fascism is the idea that my country is superior or even supreme. So the idea that one's country is special, I think that is something which is desirable, because if you belong to something, some bigger whole, to feel that there is something special that we as a nation or we as a community or we as a race or whatever group we belong to, that we can contribute something. That feeling special is not exactly the problem. Feeling that I have to prove myself superior and I have to push others down, that's when it becomes a problem.
Beautiful. That's very interesting. Just like you mentioned, that if you do not identify, if you don't have gratitude, confidence and happiness in regards to connected to your mother, if you're happy with your mother, then I remember where I stayed in my colony. Then I called my mother, Amma. But then instantly there were other mothers, Santosh Amma, Saru Amma, or that, like that. Every other personality will also be mother only. Even though you're calling all of them mother, giving them that respect, you still have your own mother. But if you consider that only my mother is mother and everybody else is low class, that means you actually do not love your mother. There is some psychological problem with you. No. You're threatened by your own mother's identity, and therefore you are trying to see nobody should be mother, nobody should be mother, nobody should be mother. This exclusivity claim, whether about motherhood, whether it about nationhood, whether it about religionhood, everywhere, I think in our Prahlad Maharaj, he says, if you cannot see divinity everywhere, you somehow or other become in one sense Hiranyakashipu only. What is Hiranyakashipu? To see God nowhere. And what is Prahlad? To see God everywhere. So the clash of maturity. Immature person sees nowhere God other than his own self. And a mature person is one who is able to see God everywhere. So it's a clash between Prahlad and Hiranyakashipu. We have to know how much Hiranyakashipu am I and how much Prahlad am I.
So now here you are, in a sense, equating equating divinity with like a broadened consciousness. So yes. Seeing divinity everywhere, similarly seeing with gratitude various things.
Yes.
So, recently I've been thinking that there are two distinct concepts. There is elevation of consciousness and there is expansion of consciousness. So elevation means you start thinking about spiritual realities. You think about Brahman, Paramatma, Bhagwan. And expansion means we start thinking about, say, our family, our country, humanity at large. Even if you're not thinking of them at a spiritual level, but you're at least thinking about something bigger than ourselves. And in the Bhagavad Gita also, when Krishna talks from 8 to 12. So first 12, 8, 9, 10 is talking about elevation of consciousness. Think of me constantly, make efforts to think of me, work for me. But then he's saying, if you can't do this, then sacrifice for some good cause. So we could say that if elevation is not possible of someone, at least expansion is desirable. So in some ways, the principle of, we could say, broadening or evolution of consciousness is similar, whether it is expansion or whether it is evolution. And if there is no expansion, if there is neither evolution nor expansion, then that is very constricted consciousness. So in that sense, whether it is seeing divinity or seeing gratitude towards parents or gratitude towards country, they are basically similar broadening of consciousness only in some ways.
They are interconnected. As you, in the middle of the thing you said, when Krishna speaks 8, 9, 10, if you are going deeper, elevating or deeper, when you go deeper into your consciousness, in Lord Chaitanya's pastime, when Lord Chaitanya was, having ecstasy, he would brush his face to the walls of Gambira. Right? Mm. So they appointed a caretaker in the form of Shankar Pandit.
Yes.
So generally what people believe, absorption makes you so unaware of your surrounding. That samadhi is also there. But there is another kind of samadhi. As you go deeper into realities of life, the higher realities, that much you become sensitive to your surrounding. So therefore, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he was in ecstasy, deeply ecstatic in separation of Krishna, but because there was somebody called Shankar Pandit and he was resting, it is natural whether you are a Shankar Pandit as a god or somebody else as a god, night time means you go to sleep. Therefore, in the army, they are specially trained not to sleep in the middle of the night. So he went to sleep. So what Mahaprabhu did, he removed the chadar and placed it on.
Yeah.
So as much as you are deeper in his consciousness, that much he became sensitive to his surroundings.
Oh, okay. Yes. So if there is elevation, you're saying that expansion will also naturally happen.
Natural, yes.
Yeah, we see that. I think when Shivanand Sen's nephew Srikant came and he was upset, he didn't offer obeisances. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's servant said, tried to criticize him, but he said, don't worry, don't trouble him, he's already disturbed.
Yes.
So that kind of sensitivity is there. So now if the two go together, that in one sense, if somebody doesn't have a broadened consciousness and they start practicing a process for elevating their consciousness, sometimes they can become very narrow-minded. Because they are concerned about their religion, their God, but they are not really concerned about humanity at large, or even people who may express faith in a slightly different way from theirs. So it can be harmful if there is only elevation without expansion. So ideally, you're saying elevation and expansion will go together. But if it is only one way, it can be a problem.
If it is only one way, if you are living in the dense forest surrounded by nobody around you, so then like the highest yogi living in the woods of the Himalayan mountains or any forest, that is allowed for them to do, because it doesn't matter what they do, what they don't do, whether they're elevated, deeply practicing elevation, it does not matter. But if you are part of the society, then there is a karma samadhi, there is a bhava samadhi, then there is a jnana samadhi also.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Are they different?
Yeah, because in karma samadhi, basically you are absorbed in your swadharma in such a way, when you are supposed to be absorbed in your swadharma, you are absorbed in your swadharma. When you are supposed to be absorbed in your bhava samadhi, means when you are doing your devotional chanting, you are absorbed in that. When you are jnana samadhi means awareness. Lord Chaitanya, as far as I understand, he was so deeply involved in feeling separation of Krishna. At the same time, he became conscious of somebody's needs of having a chadar over his body. So Mahaprabhu, like we read, there was a semi-conscious stage, conscious stage, and deep conscious stage.
Yes.
He was able to play all the three together simultaneously in a day. All the three he was able to play. So therefore, whenever he was in deep samadhi, he avoided the Jana Sangha.
Okay.
So,
that is true, yeah.
He was able to do that.
I also heard that, after he met Ramanand Rai, it's almost like it is Radharani met Vishakha, and from there, like, his Radha Bhav started increasing much more, and then he cut down on his preaching. When he was much more, was not traveling so much in the last part of his life, because say he was more in internal consciousness, so then he didn't travel so much. Because I think if you're going to be in the society, you have to be to some extent in external consciousness. Otherwise, it's going to be problematic.
It becomes, rather than saying you're deeply absorbed, you're called as desensitized human being. Just imagine if you're living in a place where it is a relatively poor state, a poor village. For your bhajan, you make a nice place for yourself. There is a water body, everything is there, nice garden is there, your garden is beautiful, but rest everybody has nothing and you are absorbed in your bhajan. How can you be absorbed in your bhajan? It is not possible only. It is impossible to be absorbed. Then you have to force yourself, this is all mundane, you have to be conscious of trying to say this is all mundane, I don't need to distract myself. But rather than, in fact, by saying that this is all mundane, you are simply saying, you know, I don't care. I'm desensitized. It is none of my business. But we don't see that. We don't see that, you know, Lord Chaitanya, Srila Prabhupada also, when he saw somebody poor, he said, hey, nobody in and around for 5 kilometers go hungry. Yes, giving food is not the ultimate goal of any sadhu. You know, but at the same time, not giving food when there is an emergency for somebody is also not a nature of sadhu.
Yes, that's true.
Giving water is not his mission. But giving water in emergency is a human sensitivity, maturity and knowledge. He doesn't say, oh, because they're starving, they need water. So therefore, I will build so many water tanks. I will no more engage in devotional service because giving water itself is bhakti. So it's a common sense. It's a very common sense.
Yeah, that's true. So basically, if you consider, say, giving water or providing like building wells or something like that, that is an activity of expanded consciousness. So a sadhu, their primary activity is elevating their consciousness.
Yes.
Sadhu won't spend one's life to doing activities of expanded consciousness primarily. But it's not that they're against it. In an emergency, we'll do it. But if somebody starts thinking that, so I think when Prabhupada sometimes critiques, like say, Manav Seva hi Madhav Seva hai, Manav Seva is Madhav Seva, his critique is not so much that Manav Seva is bad, but to equate the two is the problem. To think that we don't need to do any worship of God just because we are doing social service. That is the problem. Both have their place and sadhus are going to do the elevation of consciousness.
And that is again another one. Another one is that they not only equate, they undermine the service to the Supreme.
Yes.
No? Yeah. Like when we say, when there is a whole concept of Shraddha ceremony, there are Rishi Rina, there is Pitri Rina, there is Deva Rina, and there is Bhuta Rina. So when I offer food to the devas and rishis and pitris, so this so-called socialist, they'll say, hey, why are you wasting all your money? Garibon ko khilao. It is but natural for somebody who's practicing proper spirituality, he will also do bhuta runa because it's connected to the society, will also do that. But to say this is against this, this is against that, that is not correct. There is a great integration in the life of a real yogi. No?
Oh, okay.
He can handle them. Therefore, he harmonizes the swadharma. He harmonizes that with swarupa dharma and he harmonizes that apad dharma. Giving water for somebody thirsty in a desert like a place for a sadhu, he is apad dharma. He doesn't say, oh, this is against my swarup dharma. I don't give water, therefore I don't want to do any mundane charity. If he has to think like that, that means he's not a sadhu only. He has to take the philosophy of spirituality to avoid an emergency duty for some poor person. That means he's bringing philosophy at the wrong place. He doesn't need a bhajan place. He needs some counseling required.
Yeah, you know, our philosophy actually is, our spirituality is meant to build on our humanity, not diminish our humanity.
You don't have to be even thinking about it. It's spontaneous. I remember one of the greatest of the sannyasis who passed away, Pejar Swamiji. Now, who can worship the Lord more than him? He took sannyas when he was 8 years old. And he left his body when he was 85 years old. Every Ekadashi practiced Nirjal. Every Chaturmasi did. Every day worshipped his deity. Without fail, since he got his deity, worshipped till he became sick. Last few days he did not. One time he was coming to the temple during his Pariyaya, that means worshipping the deity. He would always be up early morning. He came at 3:30 instead of 4:15 to the temple. He could have come at 4 o'clock, 4:15, but he came little early to chant his rounds in the temple complex, then go inside the altar to worship. but he saw the guard sleeping there. So rather than waking up the guard, thinking, "Arey, I'm coming for the deity worship, but you're sleeping here," he walked back to his ashram. Then he came at 4:15, and the guard was up also.
Oh God.
If I was a pujari, when I heard this story, if I was a pujari, you know, in my consciousness, I would feel I am doing something superior and is in mode of tamo and disturb him from his sleep. You know, yeah. Somebody asked, "Oh, is it allowed? You don't have to go to Jiva Goswami to quote whether we should give water to some poor person or not in emergency. You don't need the approval of the great acharyas." And if you are looking for an approval for the great acharyas to give water, the acharyas will feel very embarrassed that I need to speak about this thing also.
You know, Prabhupada often said Krishna consciousness is common sense, but often sometimes this is not even common sense, it's actually decency or basic humanity. So we maybe overlook that in the name of being spiritual. So I think this is a very interesting diversion, but we'll come back to our subject.
Yeah, it is connected to racism only. Racism is also based upon basically how can you not be sensitive to someone who may be completely different from you. Completely different from you. How can you feel, how is it possible to feel he does not deserve my kindness because he's not part of my race? It is a screwed up consciousness. It cannot be natural. It has been brainwashed. So okay. Organized racism is nothing but brainwashed to believe in something which you don't believe in your core of the heart.
Okay. So in the core of the heart, you mean that all of us know deeply that actually everybody is similar. We're all human beings. But on top of that, there's some indoctrination because of which we feel that this person is inferior to me, or this person is bad and this person is good. Something like that. So we can say that racism is a evidence of a shrunk consciousness. And if the consciousness is elevated, then the consciousness will also be expanded. So in that sense, a spiritualist cannot be a racist, because a spiritualist will be able to see humanity in everyone. Yes. So
absolutely. Yes.
So now there are, you know, I have a diagram which I would like to show you here. I gave a class on racism, so that I had prepared this. And okay. So basically, when we talk about equality, there are four levels. That there is equality of identity. And essentially, we are all who are equal. Everybody is equal as a spiritual being. Yeah, so everybody is equal as a spiritual being. But in terms of equality of ability, everybody is not equal. That different people have different abilities. And this we just see in a classroom, different students have different ability. But then there is equality of opportunity. Say, in terms of, say, when the American Constitution says that we believe that all people are equal, what they essentially mean is that everybody is equal in the eyes of the law. The law shouldn't discriminate against one person or another person. So equality of opportunity. And then if you talk about equality of result, you know, we can't have equality of result in the sense that, say, you know, if we have an exam that is being passed, so if there is 50%, if there are 15% of people from a particular class in a particular community, and there should be 15% doctors, or there should be 15% engineers. And if the number is less, that means there is something racist in the society. So I talk about racism at this equality at these four levels. So now there is one, I showed this for one reason. So at a spiritual level, we all accept that we are all equal in identity. But even the idea that some race might be superior in some way in ability and some race might be inferior, that is itself considered racist. So, but we do see that if we start from biological characteristics, say people who are Africans or Americans, Africans or Europeans, they are physically usually taller. They're physically more well-built as compared to, say, Chinese or even to some extent South Asians. Then if you look at even in America, where they say the country is so racist, basketball is all dominated by blacks. And they're not, and even when all the owners and the coaches were whites, still most of the team members are black. So to say that certain groups of people may be better than others at certain things, and conversely, that would mean that certain groups of people are not so good at certain things. So like in India, it seems Jains are very good at business. And there are so many businesses that are mostly run by Jains. So would we call this, in today's perspective, some people will call this racism, but just as individuals are different, and could it also be that people of certain races have certain abilities more and some races have certain abilities less?
This is, like we put that slide, it's a very important slide for people to understand. Okay. Opportunity should be given to everybody.
Yeah.
Right, please put that slide. Yeah. See, opportunity has to be given to everybody. But to artificially bring the result to the equal level is destroying the growth of the human society.
Yes.
You know, like, for example, if I want to join a cricket coaching camp, right? So everyone wants to try, they should come there. No, it doesn't matter from which background you come, whether you're from Mumbai, whether you're from Delhi, whether you're from Haryana, from wherever, everybody, the coach has to accept everyone. That opportunity has to be there. Because I'm identifying that I'm a future cricketer. Okay. But then, if the coach is forced by the so-called socialists and liberals, no, you have to choose three from Bombay, three from Delhi, three from Bangalore for selecting the team so that they're the proportionate people involved in the team. You will have a team which is socially correct, but the result of that team will be very destructive because you have not chosen based upon their competency. Rather, even in regards to result, he wants to make it equal. The society will not function.
So we could say that it's very, sports is a very good example. I think it happened that, should I close the slide? Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think it happened in the last World Cup that in South Africa, they lost a critical match, and last World Cup was sometime before that. And it was because they had a very informed batsman, a player, but they dropped him to have a player of a different race included to have the composition. And it created a furore in the cricketing world to some extent. So in one sense, we want equality, but we also want success. We also want results. Say if we have a hospital and if we say that we want this percentage people from this hospital or this community. But we want doctors who are competent, not that doctors have to be like, the composition of doctors need not be socially precise, that it has to be this many people. So yes, I mean, if we look at it from the results perspective, it is common sense. And to say that incompetent people should be allowed to get there, actually it's unfair for even those people. In America, it has happened that...
It is both, yeah.
Yeah, in America, it happened that because of the diverse, they have a diversity quota. So they had many black students get into Ivy League universities, even when their say, CGPA or whatever was not that good. And the result was they found that many of these students, they would drop out from Ivy League. Because what happened is that they would have done much better in maybe a little lower level college. But here everybody is so brilliant and they just couldn't cope up with it. The teacher will also speak at a particular level, teach at a particular level. And then they couldn't cope. So it harmed the overall caliber of the university. It also harmed the caliber of, it harmed the future prospects of these students. So mandating equality of results is destructive.
It's a common sense, also statistically also proven.
Yeah, it's true.
Therefore, in the Bhagavad Gita, if you see, one of the best principles is diversity and duality. The diversity is a universal principle. When the diversity is destroyed by creating a synthetic uniformity, you know, it is not possible only because, as you mentioned, if you place a person in his strength of his area of strength, he flourishes properly. But if you force him to go to a group of people who are different from him so drastically, then he loses his identity and he cannot become this identity also.
Oh, okay.
And therefore, those who propose this kind of philosophy, I always tell them, okay, since everybody is equal, all doctors are good, why the hell you always want to go to the best of the doctors? Go to any doctor for your heart surgery. Why do you create a distinction between this doctor from that doctor?
Yes.
No, so true, you don't go to a doctor who just started doing the heart surgery. You go to the best of the doctor. Even the best of the communist leader, even the best of the socialist leader, even the so-called disruptive students who are talking about, you know, even they, why talk about when they're eating ice cream, why can't they eat any ice cream? They are creating racism between the two ice cream. They are creating racism between two donut. They are creating racism between shoes, what they are wearing. Shoes, what is shoes? Should be most insignificant. But there is racism among the shoes also. This brand, that brand, this brand cost more. I would prefer buying this brand. All these big, big Hollywood actors and actresses, they talk about so much of, you know, liberty, equality. But they go crazy if the branded shoes are not there according to their choice.
Yes, so true. Yeah. You know, equality as a value is good, but you know, there are other values also which are important. Like, say, yes, our these other values come into picture. Say, if somebody wants to get married, you won't say that everybody is equal, just pick up anyone. Nobody will do that. So, there are other factors to be considered also. So then you talk about diversity and duality. Means what was the relationship between the two words, or relationship with
diversity is the reality of universe.
Okay.
And yes, duality means I remember talking to an astrologer. He said there is a particular house. When in that particular house, when some particular conjunction happens, conjunction is the unity of two grahas. So when the two conjunction happens in particular house, so that gives rise to genius personality's birth. And along with that geniusness, there is some inherent madness also.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So duality means there is brilliance and then there is mania. So you're saying that is a duality.
Yeah. Okay. Like Prabhupada said, it is but natural a milk-giving cow might kick also. You can't say, I want only milk, not the kick. So the intelligent people, the competent people, the able people, unfortunately, they will also have an inherent arrogance. The confidence turning into arrogance might happen once in a while. If it becomes a collective arrogance, then that should be protested. It's an individual arrogance once in a while that should be tolerated.
Okay, so duality, you're saying in the sense that in the name of equality, we cannot end up rejecting competence. So we have to respect competence, and with competence, there is the possibility that some people may become arrogant. So, but just because there is a possibility. Sorry.
They will become boastful. In the Ramayana, Hanumanji, when he was told to, you know, jump across the ocean, he saw all the kapis, you know, it is not that they were humble. They were humiliated, they were depressed in one sense. Oh, we can't achieve this. We are a failure. So in such a condition, we expect Hanumanji comes and he says, I can't do anything. It's not in my control. I'll try my best. it will only cause greater depression among those monkeys. So what does Hanumanji do? Hanumanji becomes boastful. We should read that Valmiki Ramayana. So if that is called as boastfulness, you know, if you are forcing everybody to become humble, it is not possible. And it should not be possible. Humility is not the great quality independent of connection to something tangible.
Yeah. So, oh,
no, just being humble is dumbness. That's all. That has to be connected to something tangible. So similarly, somebody is boastful and it is connected to something tangible, that boastfulness becomes confident. And this humility is connected to tangible, it becomes ornament. Otherwise, it's depressing.
Beautiful. So that means we have to go beyond the stereotypes of what is humble and what is arrogant. So because sometimes what we call as arrogance might actually inspire confidence and energy in others. And what somebody might call as humility can cause lack of energy or depression or hopelessness in others. So, yes, that's a good point. And so just going back to this, I talk about these four things. So we cannot mandate the equality of results, which is definitely undesirable. We said that. But so now at an individual level, we acknowledge that there is diversity in ability. But is there this, it seems to be an observed fact that there could be diversity in ability even in races, or rather larger groups, whether it could be say particular religion or particular region or whatever it is. So now there is the fear when this is brought up that it may lead to racial domination. There was this theory of eugenics where Hitler and other scientists wanted that we will create the perfect, Hitler and scientists of his times wanted that we'll create the perfect human race and we'll eliminate others. So people feel that as soon as we bring in the idea that one race could be superior to others, that will take us down that track. But as you said, it doesn't, like, we can acknowledge that in certain areas, one race might be better than others, but that doesn't necessarily mean that that race is better in everything. And that doesn't give that race the right to dominate others. It is just that in this area, you may be good.
That's the point is, and you see in your own common sense observation only, is there any chance for, you know, people from Andhra Pradesh, I'm just giving an example, to compete in the sprint race against Africans, 100 meter dash, you know, American Africans, you know, 100 meter dash, 200 meter dash in the sprint. What is the chances a Telugu person competing with them? What is the chance? So is it organized racism? Is it organized racism that every time, since the time of Jesse Owens, right? Jesse Owens, right in the presence of Hitler, defeated Louis Long. You know, he won 4 gold medals. We studied, this was there in our textbook, 1936, in the Berlin Olympics, right? So then that time for Louis Long to go and hug Jesse Owens, you know, to prove, wow, you're a winner. He showed that sportsmanship. But when Jesse Owens comes back to America, his own country president did not acknowledge him because he was a black. That is racism.
Okay.
That is racism. So Hitler was a racist. And because he had the power, he tried to make the entire Germany racist. But the Germans, not necessarily a racist country. It was the political and the systematic presentation, you know, brainwashing the people that we are superior race, we are superior race, we are a superior race. Otherwise, how is that possible in 1936 when there was a height of, you know, German Nazi racism in the public place, Louis Long, you know, congratulates Jesse Owens, who was a black person. Even America did not do, because even though he won the gold medal for America, American president did not do that. It is a recorded thing. No.
Amazing.
So therefore, collective racism, you know, it is, as you said very clearly, in some particular field, one group of people will always prevail.
Now, social justice people, they might say that if you say Telugu people can't compete with African Americans, that they could say that it is not because of inherent genetics, it is because of upbringing. That Telugu people do not have the kind of culture, they don't have the kind of infrastructure, they don't get the kind of facilities, and that's why they don't do it. So it has been to some extent say, maybe, so the idea is there is something inherent and something which comes from upbringing. So racism is associated with the idea of those who strive for social justice is they say all sort of diversity is because of social factors, or diversity in the sense of inequality. And if we corrected those social factors, then all diversity will go away. But it seems that even if all social factors were adjusted, still some groups of people may naturally be competent in some fields. That could be there in their genes itself.
So therefore, it's very interesting. You know, it's a talk, but to invest that much of resources to create equality amongst all race of the people, let us invest all our money to prove our point, make the Telugu person run against the best of the athletes from the African American and win the gold medal, and we are proving the point. But the point is, you are investing your resources just to prove one point, but allow them to grow where they are good and invest in that section. Okay. Rather than trying to prove your point, invest so much of money, and meanwhile something else will come up, and that will prove another point only. Oh, but you know, these Japanese people are, you know, there is a place where Japanese are living for 100 years, 100 year, 110 year, 120 years also. But at the same time, in some other area, having the same environment, same food habits, people are not living for 130 years. So how much can you fight against the nature, you know, if the nature is forcing us to handle the diversity, the social scientists and the liberals, how much will you fight to create the uniformity, which is very synthetic and artificial?
Yes, that's so true. So, in a sense, we can't really impose our moral ideas on nature. So nature may not accept our idea of that all races should be equal. Rather, we have to accept the starting point where nature has put us, and then we move forward from there. And we, so now there is this black conservative thinker, Thomas Sowell. So he says that there are two kinds of vision of humanity. And he says one is the, he uses different words for it. One is the, like the evangelical or reformist vision of humanity. And the other is, he calls it the tragic vision of humanity. So the tragic vision is, he says, like, life is inherently problematic. Life is inherently unfair. And the best we can do is, like in Prabhupada's words, make the best of a bad bargain. So he says, there are no perfect solutions to life's problems. There are only trade-offs. And we often have to do the, not even the best trade-off, the least intolerable trade-off. So for example, you use the example that say, if there are 300 people in a ship, and the ship is sinking, and there are 100 people, there are only 100 life-saving jackets or whatever, 100 people can go on a boat. So now if we say equality is the absolute value, let all the 300 people die, will be equal. But this is, life is tragic. So some 100 people have to survive. Now, which 100 people, we could use different criteria for deciding that. But ultimately, this life doesn't allow us perfect solutions. So life is inherently flawed, And from that flawed basis, we have to build and make the best of what we can. That's one vision of humanity. And the other vision of humanity is that life is fair. If there is any unfairness, that is because of human systems, because of the way we are governing, because of the way of our education. And it says the left is more and more in terms of all problems are attributed to the systems which we humans have created. Therefore, destroy the system and replace the systems. Whereas the left, sorry, that's the left idea. And the right idea is these systems are functioning, and for their functioning itself, many generations or millennia, centuries, people have thought about it and they got some systems working. So don't dismiss them so easily. So my thought was that the Bhagavad Gita's vision is also more like tragic, may not be the best word. We may not want to use the word tragic. But the idea of this world is we can't have ideal solutions. We basically have to have trade-offs. Isn't it?
So therefore, Gita, you know what Robert Sowell, what is it, Robert? What's his name?
Thomas Sowell.
Thomas Sowell. Yeah. Use the words which we may not appreciate the word, but the concept is, the concept if you see, like when Krishna talks about Varana system.
Hmm.
Now, I remember listening to another very interesting scholar. He said, the Brahmana fights Agyan. That means he fights ignorance. Hmm. He is good at fighting ignorance. Kshatriya fights intrusion, or Kshatriya fights Araksha.
Okay.
Vaishya fights Abhava. Vaishya fights insufficiency. Shudra fights Alasya. Shudra fights indolence. So he said, in every aspect, everybody is leader, but everybody's leadership is of a different nature.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when a Brahmana is fighting Ajnana, and you try to force a Vaishya to, you know, like I do not, like recently somebody asked this question in our educational conference, you know, just like there was in Gurukul, everybody should study Vedas. We should bring back Vedas. We should bring back Mahabharata, should bring back Ramayana. I said, that is again another kind of Machiavelli system only. Not everybody studied everything. A farmer in his entire life must have not read Bhagavad Gita or Bhagavatam or Ramayana, heard the stories.
Hmm.
And had a great devotion also. But if you say, give him the book Ramayana, he should also read. Make us most fortunate. So he will not be able to read. And you will not be able to work on the field also. No.
Mm. So
therefore, idea, what Gita says, Gita says, the limitation of the nature is not a tragedy. The limitation of a nature is a facility for each race to contribute with others where they lack. My strength is your weakness, and your weakness is my strength. Therefore, wherever you lack, I will contribute. Wherever you lack, I contribute. That is the whole perspective of Gita. And therefore, in the very third chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, what does Krishna say in Karma Yoga? He said, this whole evam pravartitam chakram nanu vartayatiha, this beautiful chakra. And what does he talk about? He says, the devatas and the human beings. Let us say devatas are superior race. And human beings are inferior race.
Okay.
But what is he talking about? They need what? They need some eulogy. They love that. Give that to them. They will give you resources. If you want to see it from a capital perspective, if you want to see it from a management perspective, if you want to see it from whatever perspective, you know, there is a cooperation. From the Yajna perspective, there is a cooperation. The black African race, again, take, you cannot dance like them. The rhythm in their dance, no. However much I try, I love to dance, but now I can't, I've broken my knees also. You know, but see the kind of dance they do. There is a rhythm, it's a naturally inbuilt in them. Appreciate that. But if you say, no, I also want to dance like them only. Yes, if there is an exceptional Telugu guy, if he wants to dance, it's okay that he should be trained in that. Nobody should say, no, you can never dance. You're a Telugu. It is not possible for you. If he forces, no, I want to do it. He can dance like the black people. But to make every Telugu be like a black person in dancing or in running, that's a waste of your resources, waste of your energy, and waste of your entire understanding of logic of life.
Oh, okay. This is a, that means you could say there are two extremes. One is to absolutely equalize everyone. Say all races are equal. And that is not only factually wrong, but socially also it will be destructive, because different groups of people, they can complement each other and they can all can help society go together. So to equalize everyone would be unhealthy. If you can say that as one extreme of the pendulum. Another extreme could be to say that everybody in this group has to be like this. So it's not, so somebody, say somebody who might be, let's take somebody who's a Jain, they may not want to do business and they might be good in something else. So they need to be facilitated for that. But to expect that to impose any stereotype, the stereotype of equality on a whole group, or the stereotype of speciality in one area only on a whole group, both need to be avoided.
Yes. Therefore, life is very dynamic. You know, life is very dynamic. When people ask this question to me, why there is a disparity? I said, it is not a disparity. It's an opportunity for like again, you know, I'm giving an example of astrology. It is said that when this astrologer told me, he said, why every time outside the temple, other than the organized temple, you know, like Rishi Ravi Shankar's temple, our ISKCON temple, you don't find beggars sitting outside. If you go to all the most traditional temple, every temple will have beggars sitting outside. One may say, oh, this is very sad. So what I heard, the most powerful people, they are influenced by, they have a great connection to Surya Graha, Mangal Graha, Guru Graha.
Okay.
Right. But if they want to avoid the wrath of Shani, because Shani always stays with such people. And he is the breaker of your ego. So when you go and serve such people, then you remain humble. Therefore, the society to have people with all kinds of background is very important, because the successful person, when he sees underprivileged, he feels grateful that I am not like this, and he feels sensitive and compassion to those people. And those who are underprivileged, they'll feel sorry, I did something wrong maybe in my life, therefore I'm in this condition. Let us not discuss the technical karma philosophy, but that is the mood of that person. And therefore, when he receives charity, he becomes grateful. If this disparity is giving rise to such beautiful qualities, you know, why not? You don't create beggars, but they are there always. No, since 70s, Indira Gandhi said, Garibi hatao. No, Garibi to hata hi nahi. Wo khud hat gaya abhi. No. You know, so that is, go to anywhere. So this principle is what you said, let there be dynamic understanding. Let us not make rules. Let there be a spirit of rule rather than the rule itself. No?
Okay. So I didn't understand when you said disparity is good. That's the point I understood. But how did you connect that? Not that disparity is good, but disparity can be used for good. It can bring compassion in people. Yeah, but how did you connect that disparity with astrology? I didn't get that part.
So because the astrologer will tell somebody is very powerful person, he said, to keep your resources intact, you go and serve the poor people also. Therefore, when you worship the Lord inside the temple, immediately when you come out, you'll find the poor people, the beggars.
Okay.
You know, so, you see, therefore it is said a king early morning when he gets up, Chanakya says this, when he gets up in the morning, why does he see, you know, Kubja was there, or our Trivakra was there, or Mantara was there? So they disfigured people, eunuchs, and then the, you know, early morning sun is, along with the bandis offering him glorification, the king is also supposed to see such people every day in the morning hours.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so that you do not enjoy your luxuries. You see that I have a responsibility for my citizen also. And Hitler wanted to eliminate them. My country should not have such people. But
Who
in
wanted
the
to eliminate?
Vedic scripture, it is said,
Who
Hitler
wanted to?
wanted to eliminate people who
Oh,
are,
Hitler, yeah.
Hitler wanted to eliminate such people.
Yes,
He said,
yes.
no, we don't want. We want to create equality of resources, equality of prosperity. Not possible.
So now, if we say phrase this, we are discussing overall racism. So we phrase this in terms of left and right. So left can go wrong when it will say that all races or all social groups should be considered equal. And right can go wrong when it says that this group will inherently be superior and this group will inherently be inferior. Or say this group or this individual, because they belong to this group, so inherently they have privilege and they are superior to others. So we, in a sense, in our history, we have had, or it's highlighted when right goes wrong, when one race is it claims superiority over others, or even we can say another grouping, one nation has tendencies to dominate others, how that leads to destruction. So the extremism of the right has been highlighted in human history, but the extremism of the left is not highlighted that much. Now, if you try to bring about equality, what are the consequences of that? That is not so well known. According to some statistics in the USSR and China, it's 100 million people were killed by the government itself. That's more than World War I, World War II, three, almost 2 to 3 times more than that. But still, so they try to impose equality in various ways. They said, say, all farmers are equal. So if some farmers are wealthier, they must have exploited the poor farmers. And that's why take their wealth from them. And it seems in Ukraine in 1929, it's not talked about much. There's one of the world's biggest famines. Almost 10 million people died. And it was entirely man-made, in the sense that all the wealthy farmers, they were dispossessed. And then all the poor farmers, they didn't even know how to farm so well. So there is, within the left ideology, there is a presumption that anybody with power must be manipulative. And anybody without power must be exploited. But somebody might have gained power by competence, and somebody might be poor because they lack competence. So when we took away all the competent people, in fact, they had those gulags, which were like the Russian concentration camps, where they sent all the farmers there. And these poor people, they just couldn't farm. Now, of course, there are many other factors over there, but the idea is that trying to impose equality can also create serious problems. And history has demonstrated that, although that is not highlighted so much in our teaching lessons on history. So now, with respect to our discussion was that, so some certain races could be superior, that we can grant that, and we can say, in a sense, that in the caste system or in the varnashram, it's almost like an ingrained assumption that, say, the Brahmanas will be good at certain things, the Kshatriyas will be good at certain things. So that is not racism. That is just an acknowledgement of the fact of nature. It will become racism if Brahmanas start claiming that, not that we are special, but we are superior to everyone else, and everyone else has to serve us irrespective of whether we are contributing anything or not. So, but it's functional, it's not racistic. Is that how you see it? Phrase it?
Yeah, so basically what happens, therefore in the Shastra, if you study, take for example Manu Samhita, those who condemn Manu Samhita have not read Manu Samhita.
Okay.
I guarantee you, and even if they have read, they'll be very selective to find out what Manu says about women, what Manu says about Shudras. But if you read, I'm also compiling a book on Manu, working for a few years. So there are more verses condemning Brahmanas by Manu. There are more verses he condemns the Brahmanas compared to speaking ill about women. First of all, he doesn't speak ill about women. Even if you consider like that, he's speaking ill about women. but he speaks more ill about the Brahmanas. He talks about Brahmana becoming a Chandala. Now, Chandala is not a community. Chandala is a consciousness. Happened to be part of certain habit system, certain activities. No? So therefore, when we talk about, I think you're going to discuss that also. The point is, when in the second chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, how does Krishna begins to Arjuna? He says, Arjuna, you're not this body, you're a spirit soul. 2.13. Right? And 2.14, suddenly Krishna changes the tune. He identifies twice with his race. Is Krishna contradicting? Does he have a, you know, what is that double people have, you know, personality?
Split personality. You
know, bipolar?
Bipolar.
Personality. One can say bipolar. No, basically, the foundational identity is that you are Atma. The functioning identity is that, Jarjun, you are from a Bharata race, you are from the Kaunteya race, and Prabhupada writes, higher birth gives rise to higher responsibilities. A great heritage gives great responsibility. Therefore, if you are connected to greater resources, why, for whatever reason, the greater resources gives rise to greater responsibility. I say it should give rise to gratitude. It should give rise to opportunity. It should give rise to contribution. And it should give rise to humility. Somebody is born in that kind of family, you should feel, you know, I'm so fortunate that I got a greater opportunity compared to these people. Let me use it for the right reason. But if he just says, "Arey, I am a Kshatriya, I am a Brahmana," and does not contribute anything, then he becomes a Chandala.
Nadi and a Brahma Bandhu, Chandala.
Yeah, no, so like that. He becomes fallen. Okay. So many verses he has said. Similarly, women by nature, you know, they are considered as great jewel. No, extension of Lakshmi, extension of Narayan. So she, the Vedic society considered she should be protected. Why? Because she is representation of Lakshmi. You know, you do not throw your jewels in a public place. A jewel is always protected. Otherwise, it is, therefore she is called as Kanya Ratna. No? She is called as Kanya Ratna. You know, so there is a gender inequality. As I said in the beginning only, human being by nature can make mistakes if that facility, that situation is there. That is called as human weakness. But when human weakness becomes systematized, that becomes Rakshasi Vritti. You know, nip in the bud has to happen. Right. So just like now, you know, like recently the rape happened in Uttar Pradesh. Yes. Certainly the culprit should be given death penalty, cut off their hands, cut off their leg, you know, whatever need to be done, they should be done. Right. But this so-called feminist, who are privileged class of people, when they talk about women can go anywhere, anytime, anywhere, when do they go? How do they go? They are going with their high sophisticated car, which doesn't break down, with 4 bodyguards. Why the hell are you taking bodyguards? Go in a rickshaw when you're speaking that knowledge in the middle of the night, 12 o'clock. The so-called feminist people, they should go in rickshaw, middle of the night, and then give declaration to women that women should not worry. You can move around the city anytime and anywhere. If you're able to practice that, then you give that kind of advice. We should know how the society, unfortunately, is functioning. There is a lack of safety. There is lack of resources. So you tell them to be empowered, grow nicely, women, grow nicely. But don't make them falsely adventurous. That is not going to contribute in their life.
You know, this is a very serious point. So if we continue this discussion of equality, so we cannot artificially create equality. Say a man can go out at night in a private place. Of course, even men can go out, they can also be robbed and other things. But still, relatively speaking, so to say that man and woman are equal, and in claiming that and propagating that, we are putting women into positions of greater vulnerability. And then when they're
greater vulnerable,
and then when they are, and when something bad happens, then we blame the society for that. So, but instead of that, okay, we could say society should be reformed, but we also have to live with society as it is right now. We can't demand a utopia. So we may aspire for a particular way of society should be, but we also need to educate people in general about how it really is and to deal with reality.
And because those are demanding utopia, they are having a lot of guards protection.
Yeah.
Is it not hypocrisy? That means you yourself know the society is not prepared for this kind of reality now.
Yeah. Say in America, some people
by rickshaw first every day in the middle of the night. From your midnight parties, call a cab, go in rickshaw because you have guards. The ordinary girls don't have guards. They have to depend upon the rickshaw. They have to depend upon the cabs. They have to depend upon the Ola taxis. And there are unscrupulous men, perverted men, looking for such an opportunity to trample and to exploit. Then you can't say that every taxi should have a CCTV connected to the police department. Right? The ratio between the police and the citizen, it's huge in Maharashtra itself. If there is a ratio between one police to citizen 3,000, then one police, how much can he do?
That's so true.
No.
So, this is it's a delicate issue, but I have two, three thoughts over here. First is that that say in the West, maybe a woman might be able to go out at night. I don't know. They might be able to go out and maybe they may not get, they may also be threatened, but they may not be threatened. We can say that maybe the possibility is less there. Maybe the possibility is more here. So, when that Delhi gang rape had happened, there was this documentary which was made, India's Daughter, which tried to portray that Indian culture itself is responsible for the domination of women and for the exploitation of women. So the Indian culture holds that women's place belongs to the home. And that's where, and if a woman goes out, that itself is her arrogance. And if she's unprotected, then we will exploit her. So now I had a lot of objections to the way they portrayed things, but it does seem that in some societies, women are more vulnerable than other societies. So to what do we attribute that? That is it something that, coming?
Okay.
Yeah. Is it something coming from the original culture? Is it a perversion of the culture? We can't just say this is like a few people's mentality because it does seem to be a significant number of people. Like I have talked with, I talk with devotee, even Indian devotee ladies. They say if they're in America, they can go in a bus or a cab. They can go, and India often, especially in Kolkata, they may be groped or something like that. That kind of thing doesn't happen in some parts of the world. It happens more in some parts of the world. So what do we attribute it to?
Absolutely. There is no question compared to the groping issue. Shoes and then I remember the young boy during Ganesh festival, we had a group of people. We'd go around to the pandals telling their people you should have 10-15 volunteers, saying that the girls don't get abused, in this. That's a part of your, that's what originally Bal Gangadhar Tilak wanted, cultural people. Now because this Ganesh festival is becoming a facility for unscrupulous children, to do all these things. We should let us stop this. Go around doing this, Yeah, I remember, and stopping the film music to be played in the Ganesh Pandal. We used to do that. There are a group of young people doing this. know, so therefore it is natural. If you go to Jagannath Puri Yatra, big Yatra, one of the reasons where a lot of young people come, irresponsible young people, no, that is not because of their inherent culture, because of their lack of connection to Vedic system. They're doing like that. Right. So number is there, but to connect it to the, you know, so the point is, you can say socially India has got large number of young women getting abused. You can say that. That statement is the truth. But going back and connect it to the scripture, because originally that is wrong. You know, for example, in America, I was talking to an American student. Well-educated American student, not leftist, not right-wing, but statistically connected. So American campus, please open and see. When you come to the college, they are given an initial talk by the college that how when you are drugged, when you are drunk, the abuse of the girls is very, very higher, up to 18 to 20%.
Yes.
So therefore, to say that, oh, because they're Americans, therefore they're abuse. Oh, because they're Indians, therefore they abuse. Oh, because they're born in this kind of background, therefore they abuse. It's totally wrong. You know, these issues should be dealt based upon psychological, sociological, and administrative situation. Because no culture, because whether it is whatever culture, you know, ultimately they talk about morality, ethics, honesty, respect. How they do it, I may differ. But the foundational principle, there is some kind of value system. You know, and one of the most important value system which Sanatana Dharma teaches, is the value system is that other than your own wife, you know, you treat everybody like a mother. And if they are not doing like that, it is their problem. They should be punished. It's a legal matter, you know.
Okay.
Whether it happens in America, whether it is, you know, to create race-centric rape. Oh, because this is America, this is happening. Or because this is India, this is happening. Or because this is South America, this is happening. Because it is Pakistan, it is happening like that. You know, lack of administration and then passing the buck in the name of culture. Then human society will not grow. We are not being honest and we are not being transparent for finding out the exact reason.
So this is an important point. Then sometimes when these kind of brutal crimes happen, sometimes it's highlighted that, okay, the victimizer, the rapist was of this caste and one who was raped of this caste. Now, whether that was a factor or it was just animal desire, that is, you know, if we just phrase it in racist terms, then we are not going to solve the problem. So in a sense, we have to phrase it in the most constructive way. And of course, you know, if you talk, as you said, you talk about circumstantial, sociological or psychological factors. You know, one reason why in the West, say crimes against women might be lesser is also because, relatively speaking, it's a freer culture. So with consent, a man and a woman can come together. So a man doesn't have to use force when he can get it through consent. But in India, because the culture is a little more conservative, so when a man doesn't get something out of consent, the man will seek it by force. So there could be various factors. I'm not saying this is the conclusive explanation, but there are various factors involved. So bringing back to our topic of racism, so that even when in certain parts of the world, certain bad things are observed more than others, that doesn't necessarily mean that that is attributable to that race. We could say that is attributable to maybe the culture over there. So in a sense, it's ironical that the same people who say that, the same leftists who say that everybody should be equal and no race is inferior to another, that is very bad, they are quite ready to say that Hindu culture is very bad. And because of which so many problems are there. So if everyone is equal, then why don't you consider that if other problems are because of circumstantial issues, then these problems could also be because of circumstantial issues. Yes, bro.
Because there is no coherency in their thought process. Again, from the foundational principle only, if there is an incoherency, there is no logic, there is no statistic, there is an agenda. More than anything else, there is an agenda. Exactly. There is no transparency. Therefore, why the Vedic Sanatan Dharma, again, is very interesting, like we were discussing last two session. Sanatan Dharma, when it talks about Satya over Shraddha so much. It doesn't beat around Shraddha, Shraddha, Shraddha. It talks about Satya, Satya, Satya. No. Satya meva hi jayate. It doesn't say Shraddha meva hi jayate.
Okay. So what
again, what is, because Shraddha is very personal, personal, personal. But transparency is very, very, very connected to society, society, society.
Okay.
And when there is a transparency, then transparency, what does it do? It tells you, keep away your faith, man, when you are discussing about the larger issues of life. Now, if I want to break your faith, oh, Hindus rape more, therefore you become a Christian. Or Muslims rape more, therefore you become a Christian. You know, you are not addressing the transparent issue. You are trying to score a point against one group of community to lure them to your community. So it lacks basic honesty. Therefore, the Sanatana Dharma says, Satya meva hi jayate. Now, wherever there is Dharma, that will be victorious. Duryodhana's mother, when he came seeking blessings from her, he said, give me blessings for victory. She said, son, I can only bless wherever is Dharma, the victory will go to that party. I can't do that. You know, my mouth cannot give that kind of blessing. My motherly heart says, yes, you should win. But my dharma says, wherever there is dharma, the victory will happen.
It's amazing.
Therefore, Bhishma Dev was fighting on behalf of the Kauravas. When Yudhishthira Maharaj begged blessings from him, he said, I've been purchased. He had the honesty to say that I've been purchased by Duryodhana. These people do not have. Yes, the Fox News, CNN News, NDTV, whatever TV, they should say, we have been purchased, Baba. We can't tell the truth. They don't have this kind of honesty also. Bhishma said very clearly, I have been purchased by the Kurus. But what can I do? I still love you. Therefore, I can only bless you that you'll be victorious.
Beautiful.
That is called as Dharma. No? So as long as world functions from the principle of my religion, my community, my organization, if you're going to judge everything based upon your organization and your faith and your religion in regards to the universal principle, you know, you are not a good person in the eyes of God.
There's a lot there. First is that, so when you're talking about these examples of Gandhari and Bhishma you gave, so dharma is more associated with Satya than with Shraddha, you're saying. So
yeah.
Dharma Rakshati Dharma means it's more about dharma has to be based on truth, like last time we discussed, and bhakti is, or Shraddha is more personal.
Okay.
And then you talked about the people having an agenda or a narrative. So, well, there are what is called a news pieces and opinion pieces. So when the two are differentiated, that is fine. And somebody is giving their opinion, then okay, we know it's an opinion. But when somebody claims to be giving a news and gives an opinion, then that's when it becomes a problem.
Yeah.
So now one more point, and you said that you included in all these groupings, like say country or religion or race, you include also an organization. So normally, especially if we think we belong to a spiritual organization, we tend to think that we are above all these groupings. There is a sense of elitist mentality comes up. But in one sense, from a psychological or a functional perspective, it could also lead to the same sectarian mentality that any other kind of grouping can lead to. So how do we, in one sense, like, will it be the same thing that there is something special about the organization I belong to, but that doesn't make me superior to others? Or how do we like acknowledge that there is something special, but not become sectarian or agenda driven?
therefore again, if you belong to something, like if you're born in a privileged family, right? If you're born in a privileged family where everybody is well educated, very healthy, you know, your surrounding is good, you can feel grateful for having that privilege. But just because you're born in that background does not make you special unless you contribute to the growth of that community and the community of the entire world. You know, that privilege will only make you exploitative and exclusive and violent in your thought process. Therefore, whom you belong to, whether you belong to the spiritual organization created by God himself, you know, the God's organization, actually God has created, still you cannot claim, you know, speciality for yourself, because unless you contribute there. Therefore, somebody said collective arrogance, one of the greatest danger, because collective arrogance and collective confidence, I think we discussed this last time, when you break a bus, you burn the buildings in the name of protest, and you feel, wow, I'm so confident I can do it. But that confidence is all borrowed because of the mob. But when you go home and you have to confront your mother, father, your wife, your husband, your children, you know, you're shaking. You're not able to deal with that. So therefore, generally what happens in the modern society, people need to take shelter of an organization. People need to take shelter of a thought process. People need to take shelter of a country. As long as you take that shelter for your personal growth and offer all the gratitude to your surrounding, that is well and good. But merely because you are connected in an organization, therefore you are special, and you are hiding your weakness, your limitations, by the success of the community, by the group of people, you are the most unfortunate person. Because in Sanatan Dharma, there is no collective mukti. Mukti is always individual. You 10 friends do not go back to Godhead. Only you go if you have done your devotional service, spirituality properly.
Amazing. Yeah, Prabhupada says everyone has
only to you it. Eat. You have to fight your own battle. If the best of the prasad has been cooked by 10 people together and you have 10 best friends, they eat nicely, you may enjoy their pleasure in eating. But the pleasure of eating yourself will only come when you eat it.
Very striking.
Therefore, Vedanta philosophy talks about two things. Vyakti vikas, that is personal growth, and the growth of the society. For the growth of the person, you need Shraddha. And for the growth of the society, you need Dharma. Dharma is an external reality. Shraddha is an internal reality.
So,
just because you believe in God, that does not make you a contributor to the society. Osama bin Laden believed God more than many of the, you know, best of the priests. His faith in God is much superior compared to many of us, but is adharmic. Can you lay your life? Can the terrorists, those who are willing to die for their cause, have a greater faith than me? But they don't have a dharma. Because they don't realize that my faith is destroying the coherent living of the community, of the society, of the world. Therefore, a real personality is Shraddha inside and Dharma outside.
Oh, so even at one level, the terrorists, even if they have faith, we can also ask whether it is really faith. Like the Bhagavad Gita, 17 chapters talks about Shraddha Traya Vibhaga Yoga. Shraddha can also be in ignorance, passion, goodness. So we could say that if Shraddha is not leading to Dharma externally, then that Shraddha can be tamasic, it can be destructive. So it is Shraddha in name only, in a sense.
Yeah.
Okay. So when you talk about this Shraddha and Dharma internally, there are two things. First is that if somebody belongs to an organization and they see that going there as a way for growing individually, say becoming more responsible, more thoughtful, more contemplative, more basically like a better human being, then that is constructive. But many times when people nowadays, people take to religious organizations, you know, there are even in Australia and UK, there are many young people who are embracing radical Islam. Mm-hmm. And one reason why they do it is that they say it's a way to deal with life's complexity. I don't have to think. Somebody else will tell me, do this, don't do this. And I think that is a form of escapism, isn't it? That we can't really outsource the responsibility for our decision making to any other group. Like Krishna in the Gita says that Vimrishaita Dasheshina Itichisata Kuru. That is, you have to take the decision. So,
So therefore, it's a very interesting, very important point that a teacher cannot work for me. There is no contract. He cannot take contract for my perfection. Mm. He can take contract for teaching me the process of learning the journey of perfection. He cannot walk for me. He knows the art of walking. He will teach me the art of walking, but ultimately the practice of walking has to be done by me only.
Beautiful. You know?
So what we have done, unfortunately, what we have done, the concept of guru, concept of God also, we have done in such a way that he will do everything for me. I don't need to do anything. That's an inner spirit. Therefore, other day we were discussing Gita. Krishna is telling you are not Karta, but that doesn't mean that you are not Yodha.
Okay.
Yeah. When we say, "Arey, we are not the doer," but when we say we are not the doer, we stop functioning being what we are supposed to be as identified by Prakriti and three modes of material nature. Therefore, we are not Karta, but I'm a Yodha.
Hmm.
I could be a Yodha of a labor class. I could be a Yodha of an administrative class. I could be a Yodha of an intellectual class. And I could be a Yodha of a mercantile class.
Hmm.
But I'm not a Karta. Third chapter, beautiful. Now, while speaking about Swadharma, then Krishna says, you know, ahankara vimudatma karta miti manyate. Don't think you are the doer. You do. There is a difference between doer and doing. Doing is your responsibility, but the consciousness of I am doer will not be there. So whatever people do, unfortunately, as you mentioned, taking to radical Islam, you know, it is, one is too extreme, you know, but relatively from that perspective, every group of people, you know, irresponsible people, they look for sheltering themselves to hide their irresponsibility in the name of, can you imagine when you are irresponsible but you are called advanced? You know, that is so dangerous.
Yeah.
Therefore, you may agree that I am not Karta, but still you are Yodha. That you don't give up.
Yes. And in a sense, you know, when we say we are not the doer, it is more that Krishna says, you are not the sole doer. Tatraivam sati kartaram atmanam kevalam tuyaha. Pashyatya kritabhutvana pashyati durmati. So now you are connecting this doership with the idea of individual responsibility. That when we belong to organization, or when we learn a broader thought system, we don't have that ego that I am doing great things. But that doesn't mean that we don't take the responsibility or we don't do our responsibilities. So yes, while doing our responsibility, we have to think and we have to carefully decide how we are going to act.
Yes,
Yes Prabhu. This has been very good. Now just a couple of questions. You see that in the Vedic statements, in the Vedic scriptures itself, we see certain, not just like say skills. So we did agree that it could be that some groups of people could be good at certain things and some people will be not so good at certain things. So But it seems the Vedic, some passage in the Vedic texts, they also attribute certain moral levels to certain people. Like say, people outside Aryavarta, the people in this part of the world, they are degraded. Or Chaitanya Charitamrita said that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came on the, from the east, he came to the west. So people in the west were not very cultured, but by the influence of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, they became cultured. When Prabhupada went to the west, the prevailing notion was that in the western world, people are not very cultured. So there is some amount of presumption that certain regions are associated with certain moral levels. So is this a form of racism, that people here are going to be degraded, people here are going to be elevated?
I think if the I would comment on these 2-3 things.
Yeah.
You know, again, as Krishna spoke to Arjuna about, you know, you are a Kauntaya, you are a Bharata. The purpose was not to prove that Arjuna is superior. The purpose is to make Arjuna responsible.
Beautiful. Yes.
You know, so therefore, at some point of time, whom are they speaking to? The Vedic Rishis, the Vedas. The influence was there beyond the borders of Bharata Khanda. The Vishnu Purana and Manusamhita makes it very clear what is Bharata Khanda. When we say Yudhishthira Maharaj ruled the entire world means what? Within the land of Bharata, forget the entire world, Mathura was ruled by Ugrasen Maharaj.
Okay.
It is just 200 kilometers away from Indraprastha. So how do you make this statement? You know, Drupad was ruling the, you know, Punjab.
Huh? It's more like an emperor for whom other kings paid tribute.
Not even that. Not tribute was also based upon, you know, if I have got extra, I will give you something. You know, it was not a dominating power. It's an inspiring power.
Okay.
You know, it was not administrated power. It is an inspiring power. When Jarasandha was killed, Sahadeva was placed there. And Krishna did not keep 4 people from Hastinapur to keep eye on their behavior and activities, knowing very well that this is dharmic. He's not like his father. He will rule his people very nicely. So the rule of an emperor was more about not dominating the entire world, but inspiring the world in the principle of dharma. You rule complete autonomous for the local kings, not interfering. Right. When Balramji came to Hastinapur, the Kauravas mistreated him. Even though apparently Balramji said, what does he said? Are we have accepted your supremacy. It doesn't mean that you are powerful. I will show you my power today. He wanted to bring the entire Hastinapur to the waters of Yamuna. So they accepted the domination more based upon inspiration, not based upon, you know, brute power of weapons. Now, up until the times of Pandavas, and then eventually with Kurus and then Jarasandha coming, it became brute force. Mm-hmm. Right. So therefore, when these verses speak, again, Vedas, even though we may say it's a universally applicable, but Vedas were particularly studied within the boundaries of India. Himalaya se Samudra Paryant. Vishnu Puran mein uska varnan aata. It comes in the Vishnu Puran. It comes in the Manusamhita. In the 5th canto Bhagavatam also. Which part of the Bharat Khanda, you know, beyond the Himalayas, it is considered like that. Very clear. So beyond that, there was based on inspiration. People are practicing. Right. Therefore, in the Mahabharat, when Karna and, you know, Shalya's discussion is there. And if you study carefully, people consider Karna was the victim of racism. But if your information, Karna was the greatest racist.
Really? How?
I'm not making a statement. If you study the chapter of Shalya and Karna's discussion in regards to, you know, fighting Arjuna, there is a big verbal war between the charioteer and the chariot driver. And then Karna blasts the entire community of Shalya from Madhya Desh. No, he's like, oh my God, he just blasts. And not only that, he speaks about women. He says when the after the Pandavas were coming back to Hastinapur after marrying Draupadi, there was a discussion among the Kauravas, including Drona and others, they're singing, how do we break their unity? And one of the Kuru, I think Shakuni or somebody said, you know, let us bribe them. Let us bribe Draupadi, create a division amongst the Pandavas, or bribe Draupadi. So then Karna says, he said, you fools, Draupadi has married the Pandavas in their poverty. That time she didn't know they were Pandavas. When she has married them in their lack of identity, when she knows they are Pandavas, how do you think they will, you can break her? You can't bribe her. She is not bribeable. And then he says, you know what? By nature, women liked her more than one man. And she has it. Karna makes this statement. You know, women by nature want to have more than one man. When she have it, why would she not? Why would she reject this one? So the entire women race is abused by Karna. And in the gambling match, you know, I'm just saying how people sometimes they consider him to be the epitome of equal rights, fraternity, fighting against oppression. But he's the personification of oppression. He's the original left ideology.
Really?
Oh, you know, undermining women. And then in the gambling match, what did he say?
He said a prostitute. Because she has five husbands.
She's a prostitute. Does it matter to be, you know, having clothes or no clothes? Now you tell me which scripture, which common sense says that a prostitute can be seen publicly, completely naked. Even she has her dignity. You do not have the right even to shame the prostitute. You pay the price, dignified way. You cannot undermine. Read the Arthashastra. But just see how racism spreads without even realizing he's the epitome of racism.
You are using racism in the sense like caricaturing a particular group of people in a negative way. Yes. So he is caricaturing all women in a negative way. In that sense, that's racism.
Okay.
Yeah. No? Yeah. And then in conclusion, therefore, when the Shastras were read, why it is said that the scripture should not be given to anybody and everybody? So to make you feel privileged, to make you feel responsible, the context-centric verses are there rather than the universal principle. I would not use those verses. I've stopped using it. Oh, we Indians are superior and the Americans are inferior. I'm born in India, therefore I'm superior. I said, I'm born in Bharata. I want to be born in Bharata always and forever, as long as, you know, whenever God takes us back to the spiritual world. No, why? Because there's a, you know, Mother Ganga is there, Mother Jamuna is there, Himalayan mountains are there, so many Tirthasthan are there. The concept of considering everything is valuable is there. Your soil is valuable. Your mother is, like I remember writing letter to your uncle, grandparents, you'd write Tirtha Swarupa as against my dear father. You know, Tirtha Swarupa. Signification of walking Tirtha, you know. So therefore, when they made this statement, let us not take out of context. No, that's not because you are special. Like one other scholar said, he said every land is sacred in mother in this earthly planet because Vamandevani placed his foot. It touched every part of the bhumi all over the world.
Beautiful.
The lotus feet of Lord Vamandeva touched in the American continent, African continent, South American continent, Bharata continent. But still, if there is a choice between being born in America and born in India, I would prefer to be born in Bharat. Because Ganga is there, Jamuna is there. Our identity to Bharat is not connected to geography alone. It is connected to the spirit of divinity. You don't go and bow down to Thames River, which they have never done. You don't go down to the Mississippi River. I remember talking to one ISKCON sannyasi. He was, you know, he had to be traveling. He was on the bank of Mississippi River. He put his thread, Gayatri, and he chanted Ganga Chaiva Yamuna Chaiva. Invoked all the river in that river. And then he said, I chanted my Gayatri, did tarpan to the Lord Surya Narayan.
No? Okay. So this is very, very inclusive way of looking at things. So if I understand, you earlier talked about how the dharma was, Yudhishthir was not dominating all the countries. And then you connected it. So if I understand, the connection is that you're saying that dharma was expressed in its own way in various places. And there is sanctity to all places. And if a scripture is spoken to people at a particular place, then in order to inspire them to follow dharma properly, certain statements glorifying that place in comparison to other places might be made. So we have to look more at the intent of the statement and not absolutize the statement. Yes. So say, for example, when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu comes to the western part, it said people, they were not cultured or well-behaved. The point is not that people are not well-behaved. The point is that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu elevated them. That Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had an impact on them. He transferred. So, yeah. So in a sense, this is like, even in the, there are broad-minded Christians who also say that there, it's an influential group now, slowly getting influenced. They talk about the universal Christ. They say Christ is universal and Jesus is specific. So Christ is the only way, but Jesus is one manifestation of Christ. And that Christ can come
from, really?
Yeah. So there are quite at least 7-8 prominent scholars who are talking about the universal Christ in Christianity now. And so basically what they say is, if Jesus says, I am the only way, that is the example they give is that if a patient has come to a doctor and the doctor says, take this medicine. And then the patient says that, no, but I went to this doctor and this doctor said that, and I went to that doctor and the doctor said that, and I went to that doctor and the doctor said that. So then the doctor says, just forget everything that anyone else has said. You just take my treatment, you'll get cured. So this is not meant to reject all the other doctors. It is meant to focus the patient on taking this treatment. So we could say
that's beautiful.
Yeah. So we could say, yeah, even
that's very good.
Yeah. Even our statements also, which seem racist, they need not be seen like that.
Yeah. Because again, therefore, if you, the Shastras are very dynamic. The conclusion of that statement is not enhancing your consciousness, as you talked about, you know, expansive, it's not expanding in your thought process. We are not watering down. The roots are there. You know, it is going deeper, at the same time it is expanding. If that is not happening, then what is the point of having the best of the statement of the scripture, making you very privileged, that declaring that you are a chosen person? That's okay. What next then? You just remain a chosen person and feel intoxicated. You know, better than that, take some beer, because it comes down. You know, if you drink some wine, that will bring you down from your intoxicated state, because the intoxication power of the beverage stays for some time. But this intoxication of feeling very privileged, if it's going to stay for life at the cost of causing violence to you, you know, that intoxication is much more dangerous than drinking little wine.
That's so true. So, in a sense, moral superiority, claiming moral superiority by abstaining from intoxication, actually may be more damaging than taking intoxication, getting rid of that moral superiority. So,
Because a drunkard always feels that I'm fallen. I remember when I used to go in the bus party, you know, in the companies, almost everyone, I've never seen, I'm not saying everybody, but almost everybody, if they had eaten meat, if they had drunk, they would say, we will not touch Bhagavad Gita because we were contaminated. I said, wow. At least is that consciousness they have. We have eaten meat and we have drunk, and therefore we are contaminated. We should not be touching it.
Now in the West, we will not be able to distribute Bhagavad Gita to anyone if we follow.
No, then I would say, don't worry. Gita is much more. Gita is the best sanitizer.
Okay.
Don't touch it. Gita will not get contaminated. You know, Gita has the power to absorb your. But the principle I'm saying, their thought process was very appreciative. In my heart, I would appreciate. Wow, you know, these people are, you know, feeling that they're contaminated.
Hmm.
And here, somebody is so intoxicated by the principle of being privileged to such an extent, just they are happy with that. Like Atmaram, you know, the perverted Atmaram. I am born in a great family. I am connected to a special organization. Therefore, I don't need to do anything. And just keep harassing others. You are low class. You are useless. You are bogus. You know, you are insincere. You are this. You are that.
No. It's true. So, and this is that means, in one sense, if somebody is not following a particular moral standard, if they feel a sense of humility because of that, that is good. But if somebody pushes them down based on that, then that is unhealthy. If somebody is arrogant, then that's bad. And pushes them down, that's bad. So now in our scripture, just continuing this thread of thought, there does seem to be a tendency to label people based on certain behavioral characteristics. For example, somebody's a dog eater, or somebody is this, somebody is like that. So these terms themselves, at one level, they can seem racist. You know, that this whole community is, well, they are dog eaters, and you give them a name like that. So is it now, at least the way we use it, it is with a certain level of moral condemnation that they are so fallen. So were they more like functional labels that, okay, this is the behavioral characters of these people. So is it also like a racist designation, or just a behavioral observation?
I think just at the same time, let us see this also. They were kind of, oh my God, he's like a chandala, dog eater. For someone who has never, like I use this example to school children.
Hmm.
Those who are vegetarian, I said, okay, what will you do? You have to protect your life. There is nothing to eat. Nobody to cook there. And there is a dog. That's the only thing available. And 5 days you are hungry, what will you do? Oh, no, no, I will never eat. So to create that kind of, you know, oh my God, you know, just how can I? Because if you have eaten something, forget that. If people have not eaten the brinjal in their life, if you offer them brinjal, they feel vomiting sensation. What to speak of dog's meat? You know, to make them, give them jhatka, what do you call, you know, give them that kick to stop from doing something wrong. The scriptures use that statement. At the same time, how is that the very Vyasadev gives a conversation between Chandala and Vishwamitra Muni? The dog eater Chandala had the greater knowledge of trying to convince Vishwamitra Muni why he should not eat dog's meat.
Oh.
Quoting the scriptures, Dharma Vyada, in the 11th canto of the Bhagavatam again, he is quoting scripture to a Brahmana. So wherever there was a necessity, there was no hesitation in regards to interaction between these two community for seeking knowledge.
Okay.
They may not have dined together, being a vegetarian and non-vegetarian, but there was a facility for interaction. They were able to discuss, because a vegetarian person, for him to think about eating meat becomes very like, you know, animal's flesh, how can I eat? But just because he ate animal flesh, you may condemn the action of eating animal flesh because it constituted violence, it constituted eating. You know, like, who is that, a British writer wrote, right? Eating flesh means making a burial in your tummy.
Yes, and George Bernard. No.
George Bernard Shaw. So these kind of poetic statements are there, but if they would meet such people, they were not condemned. But when you say, but we have seen people who are condemned, yeah, again, I said, the human weakness has taken to another level of condemning people along with their action. No, you condemn the act of drinking, but don't condemn the drunkard. So the scriptures are being very straightforward when it comes to cleanliness, when it comes to, you know, austerity, when it comes to honesty, when it comes to compassion. They're very strong using that words. But that is very, very focused on dealing with the action rather than the performers of that action. It is not the sinner, but it is the sin. To give a shock, to give a jerk, to give a strong message, because scriptures are not connected to, you know, flattering and pampering our false ego. But at the same time, they do not destroy our identity. They destroy our ego, but they do not destroy our opportunities to grow from wherever we are. From there, we can grow.
Okay, so now I've heard some stories. I don't know how true they are. Say, for example, if there is a lower caste boy who is thirsty and he goes and drinks water from a well in a higher caste well or a higher caste tap, then he's violently beaten up, and then that kind of persecution happened. Or I saw a documentary prepared by BBC about India's partition. And of course, it was quite distorted, but they said that many Muslims said that the Hindus didn't treat us like human beings also. That if we are thirsty, they will not let us drink water from their tap. So because they had the sense of superiority, we felt that we would not be treated as human beings if we lived here. So you are saying that that in general, there could be some amount of purity maintained. But it's not if somebody is dying of thirst, like a child is thirsty, you cannot persecute that child or beat that child. So these are distortions. So there is some amount of regulation, but the extreme implementation of that regulation is a distortion. Is that what you're saying overall?
Absolutely, absolutely. Therefore, again, as I said, when a good people do not stop such kind of activity, that turns into organized crime. When one Brahmana saw other Brahmana mistreating somebody because he was drinking water from his lake. Now, which scripture does it talk about Shudras not allowed in the temple? Have you read anywhere? Coming to the place of the Supreme Lord. In the Bhagavatam you have read. In the Chaitanya Charitamrita you have read. In Mahabharata you have read. In Ramayana you have read. Upanishads do not mention about temples only.
What about Manusamhita?
Manusamhita doesn't talk about, you know, Devagraha. Talks about yagyas and other things.
So these are distorted social conventions.
So the temple is a place of universal integration. You know, therefore the temples in India, they do not have a distinction between man and woman also. You go to any temple, you know, men and women are there together. It is very modern to create, okay, men in this side, women in this side. The distinction was not there only. Now also, go to Jagannath Puri, same. If you go to Ranganath Swami, same. If you are standing in line, same line. Men, women are in the same line. So we are, in one sense, the traditional temples are much more liberal than the football stadium in America. No?
Amazing.
Right. But then there were people, they misused that. Like you mentioned about, you know, where women are traveling, they were toppled, they were abused, they were mistreated, they touched wrongly. That is human weakness. But the Shastric strength is, this is the land of integration. This is the energy place of Supreme Bhagavan. Everybody is equal here. No gender discrimination. No caste discrimination. Everybody receives everything.
That's amazing.
In fact, Sripad Ramanujacharya had created an equal dakshina given to a person who would sweep the temple surrounding and the archaka.
Really?
Yeah, this is a very revolutionary. Therefore, there are some kind of, you know, some people said, hey, how is he doing like this? He was one, he said, okay, after while going to take bath, he would go holding the hands of the Brahmanas. while coming after taking a bath, he will hold the hands of Dhanurdas, who was apparently Shudra.
That's no?
Kanakdas. Kanakdas was a shepherd. He was Kuruba, but a great disciple of Vyasatirtha. His songs are compulsory learned by the sannyasis of Udupi Mutt.
Okay. So you're giving these as examples of how this stereotyping that people were all looking down at certain people, that is wrong. And there are evidences of that also. So first of all, it is wrong if it has been implemented in general. And that is not what scripture says.
And wrong is other people did not stop their own person doing that. Like if you're traveling in a bus, all the men will watch. Some young people are, now also it happens. If you see some young person is abusing a girl, other women should get up and slap him. People are thinking, "Arey, I have nothing to do with this. Why should I get involved in it? If I have to blame anything about Indians, they live very selfish life. I, me and mine in regards to values which are connected to offer obeisance to your mother. But somebody else's mother is abused. You just look around. So therefore, we need Kshatriya training also. A child should be trained in Kshatriya spirit also. If he sees somebody doing wrong, you know, either he complains to the police or brings 4 or 5 people and beat up there only. You know, nip in the bud, because nobody nips it in the bud, then it gives them encouragement. It gives them encouragement. Then the bigger crime.
Yeah.
If anything wrong they did, which was crime, the good people did not stop the wrong action. They did not do anything wrong, but they did not stop one of their community members doing the wrong activity. But it was never an organized racism in Brahmin community. As I told last time also,
yes, that's
you can never unite the Brahmanas for good things or bad things.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. You know, this point about, I don't know whether I would use the word selfish about Indians. I would say that it's more of self-preservation, because we were ruled for so long. So Indians are not so much concerned about social reform. So I was with one devotee who was American. He said in the American government, the most productive immigrants are Indians and Chinese, because they are well educated, they pay taxes and everything. He says among them, we prefer Indians to Chinese because Chinese are very politically active.
Yeah.
Indians don't get involved in that way. So in a sense, maybe it's because we were ruled for so long. Let me take care of myself. If I get involved in something bigger, I'll get into trouble. So it could be that also, not just selfishness.
It has increased now. Presently, it has increased more and more.
Oh, is it? Huh?
No, otherwise, we are always a fighting race. You know, since you talked about race, we are a fighting race. Because for 1,000 years, if you see South America, the entire South American, you know, the culture, South American language has been completely vanquished by the colonizers of Europe. They speak Spanish language.
Yes.
They have a European religion. They don't have a native religion.
It's exterminated.
But in India, you know, our fighting is also not well documented. We don't document our fighting. We have preserved. I speak language, my mother tongue, the way my ancestors spoke 1,000 years ago. And it will continue to speak even 500 years ago. No, many languages will survive. You know, I worship my Supreme Lord Krishna. I know about Jesus Christ at the same time every day. You know, I have picture of my Grama Devi also. No? You know?
So you are saying that there's the very fact that our traditions have survived indicates that there was a fighting spirit. Otherwise, that's a good point. Very good point.
But you don't make a narrative. The unfortunate reality is that you don't make narrative about it. Because I am not a karta. It's happening. It's happening. You know, it's a reality. You know? So what the modern world wants you to do, write down everything. Create a system. Write the process. Give the curriculum to everybody. Give the textbook to everybody. 8 lectures on how to be humble. No, that is not Indian system. God. 6 lectures on how to be tolerant. No, experience toleration. Rather than giving a talk on, it is there part of the scripture everywhere. You don't separate humility, separate toleration. You know, I'm just giving that in the college kind of setup, school setup, you have to make like that. But it is a very interconnected system where you just experience little by little and then become part of your life.
I think they say that spiritual wisdom is more caught than taught.
Yes.
It's more like atmosphere, people and everything. Yes, yeah. True. I think one last question, this might take time. If you want, we can discuss it next time. So that is that there is often the idea of race associated with skin color, that there is the idea among some Hindu leaders that the fair skin indicates that the Brahmanas were fair skinned and the Shudras were dark skinned. And even in general in India, I don't know about the rest of the world, but in India, the fair color is considered to be beautiful and a dark color is not considered not to be so beautiful. So there are 2-3 different things. One is the very conception of beauty. The other is the association of karma with skin color. And association of also Varana with skin color. So, and I have also heard, to continue this point, that while Indians look up to the white skinned people, but when African immigrants come to India, often they are treated quite badly. And I've heard this from even African devotees when they come to India. They say the way we are treated is very different from the way, say, British or Americans are treated. Now, there could be many reasons for this, but this white and black with respect to Varana and all that. Would you like to comment on this, something?
Yeah, it's again vast subject. Again, by nature, when you are colonized for a long time, it is end of the day like the Stockholm syndrome. Somebody who is a superior victor, when he conquers you, then people start taking pleasure in saluting them.
Okay.
Now why? Because they get the privilege from them. Inside, they hate them. If you ask anyone who worked under the British Empire as a soldier, they worked under them. They offered external respect to them also. But inside their heart, they said, this Gora Chabdi, you know, they use those kind of terminology also. Right? And especially those who got educated in the British style of system, they are the one who became fascinated. Ordinary worker who worked under them did not get fascinated by them. He did his work, saluted because I need to get my work. I don't have the power to fight them, but in my heart, I'll fight them. I'll give them 4 curses. You know, They gave them 4 curses in their heart. But externally, they had to do because they were less resourceful. But those who got educated in the British kind of system, then the white skin became an epitome of worship.
Well, I think there are also reasons for that. In a sense, when Islam ruled India, Indians never thought that Islam was intellectually superior. They might have been politically more powerful. That's why they were ruling us. But when Europe came, when Britain came, they had science, they had technology, they had a rational worldview, which seemed to be superior. So in that sense, we could say there are reasons why the West was adored. We can say how valid they are, they can examine it. But so you are saying that this fascination with the fair skin is more of a colonial hangover. It was not there so much before that?
Because if you study the Indian system, see again, there are Smriti Shastras of so many varieties. Okay. Every Smriti Shastra comes with certain perspective based upon who is speaking, where he is speaking, in what context is speaking. You know, like Bhishma Dev, was he beautiful? He's called as Kunapadanta. He had a black tooth.
Oh, really?
Yeah. You know, Chanakya Pandit, Brahmana. But one of his characters is that he was not beautiful. You'll find hundreds of South Indian Brahmanas. They do not look fair in color. You'll find hundreds of Punjabis, doesn't matter which. You know, Varana, they are beautiful, fair. If you want to call fair as a beautiful, they look fair. But if you study the concept of Natya Shastra, Natya Shastra defines you know, beauty not in regards to color, it defines beauty based upon shape. No? The shape of the nose, the shape of the eyes, the shape of the lips, you know, the shape of the face. No? And therefore, like other day I was talking to one of my friend devotee, you know, some of the, you know, black people, no, charming in regards to the way they walk, the rhythm, no, the way they communicate, and there is a shine on their skin. And somebody is completely fair, gora gora, right? But it's a pale in color. So therefore, if you have studied little Natya Shastra, Rasa Shastra, then you'll understand, you know, the concept of beauty. During my time when I was growing up, the South Indian actresses were not always fair in color. Even the non-fair colored women, actresses, were considered beautiful based upon their eyes, their acting, their dance, you know.
And that was just 30
years. So therefore, now the whole concept of beauty has been changed based upon fair and lovely cream.
Yeah.
No?
I think recently
changed. Personally, if you ask me, you know, personally, if you ask me, for me, beauty is not based upon color. Never. No, after the Indian cricket team, I loved the West Indies player.
Yeah, that is one thing which is true. Indians love West Indians.
Like Viv Richards. Like Viv Richards. If you see Viv Richards, if you see Michael Holding now, since, you know, those who know, you know, there was a grace, there was a rhythm. No, there was, right? So I think it is very, very, I would say my understanding is the modern world is more superficial, more puritarian, more narrow-minded, but they claim that they are more magnanimous, more liberal, more accommodating. No.
That's true. Okay. So this is very interesting. I think even Draupadi was dark in complexion, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah,
she was not fair in color.
And still she was considered stunningly.
But she was the most beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah, she was stunningly beautiful. No?
Okay. So this association of skin color with either Varana or Karma, that might just be just a conception that has come circumstantially. It doesn't have any like Shastric basis.
Yeah, sometimes people made that statement, you know, fair means Brahmanas. But again, if you ask them, you mean that no, they'll say, Arey Baba, I was mentioning certain principles. Why you take my statement and make them absolute statement? Because when you make their statement absolute, it does not seem the universal principle.
Yeah.
So then you are forced, whether I accept this statement as universal, if I don't accept this principle as universal, then I'm questioning his words. No.
That's
so go and ask them only their entire literature. They'll say, no, I don't. They said, why are you emphasizing on something which is not so important?
So within the broad body of Vedic wisdom also, there are principles that are universal and they are the main contribution. They are what we should be sharing also. And yes, there might be some statements which don't agree with those principles. So then those statements should be seen as contextual and they shouldn't be highlighted. They are not the teaching. They are not what the tradition has focused on or what we are trying to share with the world also.
Because that is not going to benefit. That will only make you feel special, superiority complex, and feel proud. Where you don't grow and people who are, you know, be with you, they don't grow.
Okay. Yeah, then we can
also... And if I remember one... Yeah, like one devotee made a statement, you know, very heavy preacher. And people stopped coming to his program. He said, I'm just following Saraswati Thakur. I'll preach to the four walls. If that is the conclusion of people not coming to your temple, you're feeling happy, that I am just following the instruction of Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur. I preach to the four walls. Then he needs to be taken to some counseling session. No?
That's true.
People stop coming to his, listening to his talks. But he's concluding that rather than saying there is some wrong in my presentation, he's saying, no, I'm happy. I'll preach to the four walls.
So this is, so we could say that we want to preserve purity, but unpopularity is not the sign of purity, isn't it? Yeah. So it's
and consciously becoming unpopular, thinking that I'm pure.
Oh, okay. That is the
barometer of your success. How many people I chase away? How many people I offend? Less the number of people are coming, then I feel, oh, I'm maintaining the quality of my presentation.
My God, that is a very distorted mentality, dangerous mentality also, actually.
That is a dangerous mentality. Krishna is willing to adjust with the Kauravas. Who are they? The very people Duryodhan is telling Draupadi, sit on my thighs in a public place. Krishna is willing to say, adjust. Okay, you know, let us forget. Live by the principle of Dharma. Give Pandavas what it belongs to them. And if you cannot, give them 5 villages. That is the beginning of Krishna's principle. You know, he talks the highest concept, but he concludes with the accommodating concept.
So is this accommodation, I'm just playing the devil's advocate here, is this accommodation mostly like practical or political? Are we ready to do like philosophical accommodation also? Or the whole Bhagavad Gita in one sense is also philosophical accommodation because there are multiple paths. And so it's not just a practical, but we can adjust in philosophy also.
Because Bhagavad Gita is real. Bhagavad Gita, what Krishna is presenting, it is not a diplomacy. It's a truth of life. What he did with the Kauravas in Hastinapur is the political plus reality of life. You know, let us cooperate. But in philosophy of life, there are people of different shades. No, and the time factor is of the essence in regards to time is eternal. God is not forcing people to be exclusively attached to him. He says, some other be connected to me. By this means, that means, and slowly, slowly, he has the greater, because how long can you stay away from the truth? And how long can you be happy with a compromised truth? But for him, as long as it is truth, whether it is compromised, whether it is exclusive truth, Krishna doesn't care. As long as you're connected to truth, right? You're 500 kilometers away from Vrindavan, whether you're 700 kilometers away from Vrindavan, you're 7,000 kilometers away from Vrindavan, or you're driving reverse away from Vrindavan, but the path is, once you turn your vehicle, again you're back into that one. Be in the road, keep moving. That is his principle.
No? That's good. That is the explanation of Mama Vartamanu Vartante Manushya Partha Sarvasha. Ah. Everybody is on my path. Okay, beautiful.
Everybody is in my path. So we are not forgetting the essence of life. But part of that essence is Aham Brahmasmi. The principle of Brahman is everywhere. You know, somebody is a meat eater. Don't condemn him for his eating meat. Add some more value in his life. Okay, do some puja. Chant a little bit. Remember God. Offer it as Durga's prasad. Right? Previously, the meat shops were also, you know, controlled by many Hindu butchers who would have a Durga picture in their shop, which I've seen personally. You know, and Prabhupada writes about that. Prabhupada writes about this. You know, they would eat as the prasad of the Kali Mata. We can't compare that with Krishna prasad, but it is some kind of prasad. They'll elevate from there. Dhire, dhire, dhire.
So we could say the arms of dharma.
So accommodation is not.
Yeah. So the arms of dharma can actually.
Accommodation is not simply.
Sorry, accommodation is not simply political.
Accommodation is not simply being politically you know, accommodating everybody. It's not a lobby playing. Okay.
Okay.
We want this party also. We want that party also. You know, politics does that. But Shastra doesn't go like that. Shastra has the deeper roots. As you begin by that, you know, there is a depth and there is also expansiveness, widerness.
Beautiful. And I think this, that, so ultimately, when we talk about racism, I think this is a beautiful point to conclude on, that, you know, Krishna's grace includes everyone and Krishna accommodates everyone. So we need to manifest that when we are dealing with the real issues in the world. Yes, Prabhu. So should I try to summarize? I don't know if I can also. You want to add something?
Yes. I'll be fascinated to see if someone.
Okay. So yes. I think we discussed on the topic of, broadly we discussed on racism. So we started by talking about, yes, to consider one's nation, to be considered to be special because I belong to a nation. Now that could be a form of illusion. But he also said that if for everybody to belong to something, to say this is special is not bad. It's a matter of gratitude. But to think that I'm superior, that's what makes it bad. And then you talked about, say, spirituality is meant to elevate our consciousness, but also to expand our consciousness. And if there is no expansion, if there's no expansion, there's only elevation, then it's good if somebody is doing solitary bhajan. But if somebody is actually living in society, then they will alienate people. And we talked about how Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he was also conscious of Shankar Pandit and Shrikant, although he was in high ecstasy. So if the expansion of consciousness is there, that means we recognize that we embrace people from various backgrounds. So that expansion itself will at one level counter racism. And then we talked about so rather than focusing on racism, we could say we focused on the idea of group identity. It could be nationalism, it could be gender group, it could be regional groups. So I showed that four levels, that we have equality in identity, that everybody is a soul, but different people have different abilities. And everybody can be given equal opportunity, but we can't mandate equal results. See the example of cricket coach. If they have quota system, then we will not have the best team. So equality of opportunity has to be given. Then we discuss that at an individual level, acknowledging that different people have different abilities is straightforward. It's a fact of life. But could some groups of people have certain abilities more and certain abilities less? Says yes, that's also possible. So we could go to two extremes. One is to impose that all groups should be equal in every way. So you said that, you know, if we try to say that a Telugu athlete will be as good as a African sprint runner, it's unlikely. And we could do a lot of social engineering and do it, but what is the point of it? Is it worth the effort? Instead of that, train them and facilitate them in growing in what they are good at. And so one extreme would be to absolutely equalize all races. The other is to stereotype that everybody in this race will be good in this and bad in this. So if somebody from the Telugu community is very good at athletics, they should also be given the facility. And then I mentioned about this. So you actually in the start mentioned that racism, it arises from individual insecurity. So if I have insecurity, then I try to get a sense of strength from the group which I belong to. And then if it is an individual thing, it can be tolerated and it can be corrected at an individual level. But when it becomes a group thing, and the whole group of people start thinking we are superior, that's when it becomes dangerous. So like Hitler did that with the Nazis. So in India, if there was some amount of system of feeling of superiority, say certain people of certain castes felt superior, that was more of a individual failing. It was not like a systemic or collectivized, organized exploitation of people. And then in that connection, we talked about that if certain group of in life, I talked about this Thomas Sowell, that you know, we really can't have ideal solutions. We have to have trade-offs in the world. And that means that the Bhagavad Gita also says that different people are good at different things. And rather than seeing that as a weakness, we can see that as a strength if everybody complements each other. And then you said that the four Varanas, they are good at fighting four things. The Brahmanas can fight ignorance. The Kshatriyas can fight invaders. The Vaishyas can fight insufficiency. And the Shudras can fight indolence. So, and all these need to be fought in society. So in a sense, everybody can contribute. So the Varana system involves recognizing that certain people have certain attributes, certain groups of people have certain attributes, but that is not racist because everybody is cooperating and contributing. And then we discussed about how artificially imposing equality can create problems. So we discussed about the position of women. Say if there is a rape, then the woman has to be punished. The criminals have to be punished. But then we also have to recognize the society we are living in. And we can't artificially say equate how a woman with a lot of privilege and protection behaves and how a woman who doesn't have that behaves. So if Indian society, there is a lot of inappropriate behavior as compared to, say, some other parts of the world. But to attribute it to Indian culture, rather than to attribute it to current circumstances or to attribute it to disconnection from the culture. So that is like furthering a biased narrative. So it needs to be corrected, but the correction involves not blaming the culture, but changing the situations. And you also mentioned toward the end that, you know, one reason why there's so much wrong that has happened in Indian culture is because people often stayed silent. And of course, historically Indians have fought. That's why our culture has survived. But in the modern times, the tendency to fight has just, I'll take care of myself. What happens otherwise in society, that's not my concern. So even Brahmanas, if they see other Brahmanas behaving in self-righteous ways, that's unhealthy. And they should stop that. Then we talked about, are certain regions associated with, when there are regional statements about certain people, are those racist? It is not so much racist as it is more for people who are the contextual statements, for those people to feel sense of fortune and to take that fortune seriously. And okay, you are born in the dharmic statements country, so you can be elevated. So take this and get elevated. Not that the other people are to be condemned. And then we also discussed about fair color and dark color. So this idea, fascination with fair skin is relatively a modern, maybe a colonial hangover. In the scriptures, we do see that that Draupadi was fair-skinned and Bhishma was, what did they say? Black tooth.
Kunapadanta,
okay. Kunapadanta. And even the sages were not necessarily very attractive. So attraction is, Natyashastra says it's not based on skin color, but it's based more on shape. So even if some statements are there where it is associated with skin color, we should see them as, they are not the core teaching of the scripture. The core teaching is the universal principles. And those are what we should focus on, and those are what we should share. And also, there was one point about when people belong to a group, the group belonging to a group should lead to individual growth. But if belonging to the group leads to a person thinking that, let the group decide things for me, that is unhealthy. So like a karta, we are not kartas, but at the same time, we have to do our responsibility. We are yodhas, as you said. We have to do our responsibility. We don't have to have that doership. And in that connection, when there is a belonging to a group, the key point is that belonging to a group should not make us lose our sense of individuality and responsibility, but rather it should equip us to become more responsible. And then we talked about how the scriptures talk about Satyameva Jayate, not Shraddhamaya Jayate. Because Satya is what maintains social order, and Satya is associated with Dharma. So there is Satya externally and there is Shraddha internally. And if there is Shraddha without Satya or Shraddha without Dharma, then that will lead to fanaticism, and that is Shraddha in the lower modes. So holistic growth will be both Dharma is established externally, and Dharma means universal principles for human well-being. And there is a Shraddha that is growing internally. And when Dharma talks about certain, say, principles of purity or cleanliness, say meat eaters, those who don't eat meat will not
mix with people who eat meat. That is not meant to look down or condemn those people. It is meant to preserve certain standards of cleanliness and purity, but not at the expense of condemning. You talked about Ramanacharya. He was quite radical. And Ramanacharya would equated the salaries of the temple cleaners and the priests. And also he walked with Kanaka and others, with Dhanurdas. I say there's one more sensational good point you made that about this races or behavioral labels that there was in the Ramayana, it is Vishwamitra and a Chandala is talking. And in the Bhagavatam, there's the Vyada Gita. Yeah. So if you look at the, somebody might racist, stereotype the Vedic scripture, the racist based on some statements. But if you look at the broad examples, as well as broad principles, as well as specific examples, we do see that there is a, they are not racist, but they are very universal. And ultimately the scriptures are manifesting Krishna's compassion and Krishna accommodates everyone. Krishna accommodated even the Kauravas who were so sinful. And Krishna accommodates even in the Bhagavad Gita. There are different kinds of worshippers. They are also accommodated. So Prabhu, any last points you want to add, Prabhu? This was an amazing, enriching discussion.
Just amazed by how you recapped everything.
I don't know if I did everything, but I tried to do something.
That's again, see, that shows there is an exceptional ability you have to reproduce what we discussed. Even though whatever I spoke, I forgot. So I should not feel that this is racism. Why he has it, why I don't have it. So how can we create equality of, like Lord Chaitanya told that Keshav Kashmiri, you know, you are good at compiling verses, but I'm good at reciting. God has given me this ability.
That's beautiful.
I think with this point, we can stop. Thank you for inviting for this.
Thank you very much for so much of your time.
You know,
it's been wonderful.
You belong to the human race.
Yes, so true. Hare Krishna. Thank you, Prabhu.